Professor Kevin Boyer from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at the University of Notre Dame is here with me for a conversation on facial recognition technology. Kevin is one of the founders of the field of human biometrics within computer science and serves as the editor-in-chief of the field's flagship journal, IEEE Transactions on Biometrics, Behavior, and Identity Science. Thanks for taking the time to chat with me today, Kevin.
Thank you, Walter, for asking me to visit with you today. It's always fun talking with you, and especially it's going to be fun talking about ethical and social issues as they have to do with face recognition technology.
We often see facial recognition technologies mentioned in the press as being something problematic within artificial intelligence. Why exactly is that the case? Who's using these systems? Who comes into contact with them?
Let's think about the issues in terms in maybe three different categories. One is a nice, simple category, things that you voluntarily use all the time because you want to. So when you have a smartphone and you use the face unlock technology, that's something you do for your own convenience. And many people probably do it many times a day, and it's not a problem for them. If you were to board an airline and decide to use the face recognition technology for check-in and boarding, again, it's something you know you're doing, you choose to do, and you do it for your own benefit. Slightly less your own benefit. Some people may have a job where they record when they come into work and when they leave with a biometric time and attendance sort of feature. But again, those are all things that you choose to do to some degree and you do for your own purpose. And to some degree, you've automatically or explicitly consented to do it. There's another category where face recognition is performed on you because of where you go or what you do. So there's a category of application of face recognition where when you walk into a retail establishment, there's video cameras watching the people who come in. Face detection is done on the video stream. The face is extracted and they're matched against a list of people that are of concern to that retail establishment. So people who've shoplifted at that store in the past or at stores in that chain or caused some problem there. Another similar kind of thing might be done at sporting events and concerts. I've read of a well-known female music artist who has a kiosk up with her music videos at her concerts. And when you stand in front of them, your face image is being acquired by video and matched against a list of her security team's idea of people who are stalkers and might present a danger to her. You can see the motivation here, right? So in this case, you don't necessarily know it's happening. You haven't explicitly consented to it, but because of the place you chose to go, the thing you chose to do, you ended up participating in face recognition for the purpose of making the place you went or the event you went to operate more economically in the case of shoplifting or safer in the case of stalkers or something like that. So it's kind of a second category that we might see as not as easy to buy into as the first one, but not as much of a problem of the third category, which I'm about to describe. There's a company called Clearview AI that's very much in the news if you read things in this area. And they've essentially got a business model where they have gone out and collected face images from all sorts of sites, from Facebook, from Twitter, from LinkedIn, from YouTube, and they've accumulated a database that's estimated to be at 3 billion images, right? And they sell a service then to others. If you have a picture of someone and you want to know who it is, you can subscribe to a Clearview AI service, give them the picture, they'll match it against this set of data. This database of pictures and identities that they've scraped from the web. By the way, most of the companies that they've scraped images of users from have complained about this, right? And they'll sell the service to other people of, you give us the image, we'll match it against everything and return who we think it might be to you. Find out who it is. So this has a different feel to it because your image is probably there. My image is probably there. All of us who have an account on any of those social media things are probably in there and being searched against on a daily basis, yet we don't know it. We don't know who's asked for the search. We have no way of taking our image out and no recourse. So it's kind of a case where your picture, and to some degree, some part of your identity, not all your identity, but at least your name, enough of your identity to make it worthwhile for somebody to pay to get that much information about you, is being used by a commercial entity for them to make money without your knowledge or consent, or you even being informed who is asking for searches that are made against your image.
Along those lines, what can make facial recognition technology problematic in a social context?
Well, to some degree, the example of Clearview AI, a category of problematic uses of face recognition is there when your image and part of your identity is being used on the part of someone else's commercial product that you don't know about, you haven't consented to, and to make money for them without you being considered, right? You could imagine a different model where maybe if you've consented, you get a royalty every time your face is searched against, but that doesn't happen. You're being used entirely for someone else to make money. Another potentially problematic issue that's been in the news in recent years has to do with face recognition having different levels of accuracy for different demographic groups. So being less accurate for women than for men, being less accurate for African Americans than Caucasians, being less accurate for older persons than for younger persons. And this issue is not really well understood, both in general by the media, but also in the research community. There is, for example, no technical explanation of why it should be the case, and it is, that on average, pictures of two different women coming off of the web look less dissimilar, more similar, even though they're different persons, than for two men coming off the web. So this is a phenomenon that's happening in face recognition engines that's not understood by the technical community, much less understood by the community of people who use face recognition or the community of people who are the object of face recognition, what to do about it. So another potentially problematic issue, especially with all the hype about deep neural networks and face recognition, is that there are things being proposed that really can't be done, but people are buying into the idea that they can be done and it would be socially dangerous to attempt to do them. The particular example I'm thinking of at the moment is the idea of criminality from face. The concept is that you can take a face image, run a deep neural network algorithm on it as if that was somehow magic and it's going to let you do anything you wanted to do, and tell whether or not that person is criminal or non-criminal. This should be an idea that is totally debunked now. If you want to see the thread to start pulling on to realize that this truly cannot be done, and it's rare in science where we can say you can prove that something can't be done, regardless of the algorithm. Imagine Rosa Parks, the famous person, goes on the bus, refuses to give up her seat, is charged and convicted of a crime in Mobile, Alabama. How would you label her face image? You have to be able to label each and every face image to say that you can do this in general. Well, before that day, she wasn't a criminal. On that day, she was a criminal by the status of the laws at that time. Today, she's a revered civil rights icon and not a criminal. So there is no labeling to let you think you can do this problem if you pursue it in a serious sort of way.
There have been many calls to ban facial recognition outright. Is that a good idea? Is there anything we can do to make it better?
Well, let's think about moral consequences that would maybe let us think about banning face recognition. Or face recognition, in cases where we could use it, it can work, but we would say it shouldn't be done. I'm going to pick on one example from China and one from the U.S. To motivate the example from China, I'm actually going to ask some questions about things we might do in the U.S. What if we wanted to track all Asian people in the U.S. with face recognition technology? Just whenever an Asian person went to the airport, we would know, and it would get reported to the authorities. Or all African Americans or all Jews or all persons of Irish descent. As I start to say this, I'm hoping that most of the audience is feeling really creeped out, because in the standards of the United States, we would just think those things are so abhorrent and so immoral that we would consider them beyond the pale, and things that we would banish if someone thought about doing them, but we would hope people wouldn't even think about doing. In China, at the moment, there's an ethnic group called the Uyghurs, and China, in fact, has a facial analysis tool that will tell whether or not someone is a Uyghur with high probability, and allow the central government to track members of this ethnic minority as a group wherever they go in the country. That's the kind of thing that I think we would reasonably ban in the United States, right? We would say we wouldn't do that. A different example of things that are in fact happening, police departments in different places. I'm going to pick on the Detroit metropolitan area as an example, because two of the cases that I've seen in the news have come out of that general area. You have an image of someone from surveillance that's committed a shoplifting act in a store. The police have taken the photo, run it against the database available to them. I believe it's the set of driver's license photos in the state of Michigan. The face recognition system reports a match. This image from this surveillance video looks like this image from this driver's license photo. In the particular case I'm thinking of, the police take the photos from the surveillance and some other photos, and they go back to the store, but the person who was there when the shoplifting occurred isn't on duty. So they take whoever happens to be the security person, have them look at the photos, and call that a photo lineup. No longer the person who actually witnessed the crime, but just similarity of photos. And to my knowledge, there's no recording of this photo lineup of the police administering it. The person gets arrested, spends 30 hours in detention, and is questioned, is eventually released because the photos really don't look like each other. You can find them on the web if you want to look it up, just from some of the keywords of what I've said so far. And there's no other evidence. So the headlines might read, face recognition error causes a person to be arrested. I would say lack of competence or lack of understanding on the part of the policemen involved led. That was not independent investigation of a lead, right, that should be accepted by that police department as evidence enough to have someone be arrested. But it was. It actually happened. And there's at least three of these sorts of things in the news where a lead provided by face recognition is not followed through with enough processing by police before arresting somebody. And in these three cases, it happened to be African-American males that it happened to. So if you ask me, can we put in place procedures so that that doesn't happen? I'm going to be optimistic and say, yes, I believe we can put in place procedures where that doesn't happen. And I think there are, in fact, some larger cities or more carefully overseen police departments where you're not seeing examples, even though they perform more of these searches than the Detroit area does. But on the practical side, I'm going to say that the evidence is that face recognition is being used in ways by police departments that is leading to incorrect arrests because of either a lack of competence or a lack of understanding. And in the lack of understanding, the police have to fully internalize the idea that, okay, you have this surveillance photo, you search it against this database, surveillance photo of a store where a watch is stolen, database of everybody who has a driver's license in Michigan. You have to fully realize that if the person isn't in this database, you're guaranteed a false match. The person just came in on a flight from Canada, you're guaranteed a false match. If the person came from any state other than Michigan, you're guaranteed a false match. There's a little too much acceptance that if the computer said it was a match, it's more than a lead, it's certainty. And we have to banish that mental attitude from the arrest process.
This has been really fascinating, Kevin. There's so many different aspects to this issue. Thanks for sharing these thoughts. I appreciate it.
Thank you for allowing me to come and talk with you today.